tonight. Matthew 27, verse 62. Now the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees came together unto Pilate. Watch what they did. Command therefore that the sepulcher be made sure until the third day. They said, seal it, lest his disciples come in the night and they steal him away and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error, or one translation said, the last deception shall be worse than the first. I want to preach a little while tonight from the subject of the power of an image. The power of an image. Because images are something that we all deal with. There's something that we all relate to. There's something that all evokes certain emotions out of us. And I want to prove it to you right now. Ricky, I want you to put up that first image that I told you about today. I want you to look at this image he's getting ready to put up here. And even though the name of the company won't be up there, the image is going to be there. What's that? Swoosh. What's that an image of? Nike. Nobody said Reebok. Nobody said Adidas. That image is synonymous with Nike. And when you think of Nike, you think of basketball stars, you think of football stars, you think of athletics, you think of your favorite kind of tennis shoes or athletic clothing. Nike, just that image evokes certain emotions out of each and every one of you. Next image, please, Ricky. I want y'all to look at this image. My slogan is, if those golden arches are on, the church should be open. What does that stand for? Anybody? McDonald's, that's right. I'm not giving y'all no trick questions. The word McDonald's is nowhere on that image. But you can't see that image and not think McDonald's because of the power of that image. Next image, Ricky. I hate that image. Starbucks. Starbucks is of the devil. And I see women, and Carlene loves to go to Starbucks, and Grayson loves to go to Starbucks. I'd rather take a beating than go to Starbucks. But the name Starbucks is nowhere on this weird emblem. But universally, y'all know that that means Starbucks. And you ladies, right now, I see y'all thinking of your mocha latte, frappe, frappuccino with a little drizzle on the side. You can't even feel manly when you order at Starbucks. But y'all knew that was Starbucks because of the image. Now give me that next image, Ricky. That next image. That image means something to me. Somebody asked me why I don't have a crucifix, a cross with the Savior on it. Because Jesus ain't on the cross anymore. That empty cross reminds me that 2,000 years ago, he paid a debt he did not owe because I owed a debt I could not pay. That image has power to me. That image gives me hope on a bad day. I think of that old rugged cross right there. But the tragedy of the generation I preach to you in is this image. Help me, Holy Ghost. Is lesser known than the McDonald's image. They showed an image of the cross, and they showed an image of the McDonald's golden arches to young people. And did you know that more young people knew about McDonald's than they did Jesus? Can I tell you, there's an anointing coming on the church when we turn our heart to him to re-image Jesus. There's going to come a sound, and there's going to come a people, and this generation is going to know what that old rugged cross means. It's not just jewelry. It's not just symbolism. It means something to anybody that's ever been washed in the blood. To anybody that's ever been through the fire. That old rugged cross, it means something to each and every one of you. But there's a generation that they would look at that image and say, well, that's just two pieces of wood with scarlet on it. There's a generation that have no idea the power that that image should evoke into their life. It is the job, yes, even the mandate of the church to make sure the right image is presented to this generation, because we live in a time where we need to re-image the church. When they know more about McDonald's than they do God, we've got ourselves a problem. And it doesn't mean we need to draw back. It means we need to see through the eyes of Jesus and say, the fields are ripe for harvest. Where are the laborers? I'm believing God that city city on a hill is going to be the church that shows Tazewell County Jesus like no other church ever has. We're going to show them how to love. We're going to show them how to hang in there. We're going to show them how to stick with people through hard times. Everybody just say image. Because you were created in the image and in the likeness of God. Why did Satan not try to kill the elephant? Why did he not try to kill the donkey? Why did he not try to kill the dog? Now listen, I love dogs. I love animals. Don't get mad at me. Don't fall out with me. But the reason he didn't come after them was they were not made in the image and in the likeness of God. There is something different about you than an animal. You are special to God. God gave you dominion over the beasts of the field, over the fowls of the air, and over the fish of the sea. We have failed to teach this generation that they are more than a monkey. You were not an amoeba that crawled out of a pond, grew a spine, and became a human being. The devil is a liar. You came from God and will one day return to God. Evolution has taught this generation that they ain't nothing better than a monkey. That you're an animal. And I'm an animal. And Neil, you're an animal. Well, you tell kids they're animals and then you get mad at them when they act like animals. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. This image so tormented Satan because they were not God, but they were made in his image and in his likeness. He came into the garden, and through his deception and through Adam's sin, he took away man's likeness, but he still couldn't take away his image. There are times that Jake don't act like me, but he still looks like me. I don't care what his mama says. There are times Grayson don't act like me, but she still looks like her daddy in so many ways. So many times what we fail to realize is Satan was trying to get the image and the likeness. And when man failed, man lost his likeness. Man lost his dominion. Man lost his peace. Man lost his authority. Man lost his victory. But he never lost the image of God. Every time the enemy looked at him, he saw something that reminded him of his father. He saw something that reminded him, Adam, you remind me of your daddy. Have you ever met people that hate kids simply because the kids remind them of their parents? I have had to do counseling sessions before where mothers were being mean to their kids because the kids were getting punished because they reminded them of their daddy. And so many times what you go through in life is because we do have an enemy and you remind him of where you came from. That's why he's tried to reduce you to feeling like an animal. That's why he's trying to tell you there is no God, because he doesn't want you to know there's something different about you than the rest of creation. We have the choice to praise or we have the choice to walk away. That's why my praise has power. That's why my praise can shift an atmosphere. Because praise, if it comes from me, it's coming out of a want to. Creation praises him, and it don't even have to, has to. It just does. That sun coming up, that says, thank you, Jesus. That moon shining down says, great is my God. Those birds chirping on a spring morning say, ain't God awesome? Those flowers blooming in many of your yards right now show the glory and the splendor of God. That's what they do. But when a person gives God praise, it turns the heart of God, because the person ain't doing it because they have to. The person is doing it because they want to. Do I have anybody that wants to give God praise? Do I have anybody that says, he's been good to me? And I want to give him glory. See, me and we were talking today, and before anything can go get in motion, there has to be some emotion. Have you ever seen people just go through the motions and they ain't got no emotion? But you start putting some emotion behind it, and the motion starts happening. That's why the enemy gets nervous when we get our emotions on God. Because he knows that in our worship, when we let God touch our emotions, there's a motion of the Spirit about ready to take place. But sometimes God has to move out your negative emotions and move out your dead emotion and get a little prayer wheel turning. Then the next thing you say, I got a rhythm. I feel some motion coming in here. Have you ever had people hug you because they have to? I'd love to show y'all how Carlene hugs me. This is Carlene's public affection hug. Because she does not like PDA. But I promise you, she hugs me better than that sometimes. But me and Jake make so much fun of her when she gives us this little love tap. Jake says, "Don't pat me, Mom. I'm not a dog. Squeeze me." I like people that when they hug you, you're liable to crack a rib. If you're going to hug me right. And I believe that's the way the world is in church. They come in here and we say we've got a Jesus that delivered us from darkness, that is our best friend, that'll stick closer than a brother, and we're giving him a little love tap. I believe they're looking for a generation that will grab him and say, "Lord, I love you. I can't live without you. I need you every second of every day." Put some emotion behind the motion. When you get your emotion in it, things begin to change. Enemy hates image. He took away the image. He took away the likeness, but he couldn't take away the image. So then if the enemy couldn't destroy the image, he began to lie to us about what the image meant. Because say you didn't know what this image meant, and the wrong person told you what it meant, and they lied to you about the power of that image, and they told you that sign said, "Do not enter." That sign means "do not cross." When everybody that knows that's not what it means. But the devil has lied to this generation about the image of the church. I feel my preach coming on right now. Alan and Becky, when they first started coming to church, they said, "We wanted to come a long time ago, but we heard you had to pay a parking ticket to park here." I thought, what? Somebody else said, "I heard you could only come there if you were in suits." What? Somebody else said, "I heard you could only come there if you were rich." What? What bothered me wasn't that people said it. What bothered me was the number of people that believed it. See, if the enemy can change your image to keep the people away from you that God wants to use. That's why I hate gossip, because gossip is the tool of the enemy to keep people apart. That's why God ain't got no part in gossip. I never judge people by what they say about them. I judge people by how they treat me. But we've got people that have been pushed out of church because of gossip, because they have been lied on, because the church has been misrepresented. It just blows my mind some of the things that people can come up with to try to paint the image. I tell you what, I'm going to paint the image of City on a Hill. This is the most loving group of hillbillies I know in Southwest Virginia. This is the most giving church I know in Southwest Virginia. They feed families every week. They do stuff for funerals every week, and they don't do it to get attention. Hello, somebody. But the enemy comes to mess with image. The enemy's always trying to paint the wrong kind of images. Not only does he try to smear the image of the church, he tries to smear your image. Because you can't see him right if you see you wrong. I'm going to say that again. I can't see God right if I see me wrong. And so the enemy has released a sound. Everybody say sound. The enemy has released a sound in society. How does the enemy release a sound? He does it through the media. The media tells you how you should feel about yourself. There's so many young girls struggling with the way their body looks because the social media and media says, "Well, if you don't look this way, or if your hair doesn't do this, or if you're not like this." And can I tell you that some of the people look that way because they've had some surgical enhancements? And there's a thing now called Photoshop. Some of them don't look that way on any given day until they get done messing with the filters. And yet we've got a generation of young people that feel bad about themselves because we've allowed the world to tell them what image they should be walking under. Another thing that is controlling the image of this generation is the music. Now, I like me some country music. But if I listen to it all day long, I'm going to be depressed. I'm going to be miserable. I'm going to be a little bit, you know, hard to get along with. But I tell you another thing I couldn't listen to. I couldn't listen to rap music all day. I'd be doing drive-bys on people, busting caps in people. What you listen to determines how you feel. I'm going to find my real audience in here. Before we used to play football games, they would play Iron Man. Okay, let me find my real rednecks. Does anybody remember the Road Warriors? You know you do, JR. And when they would come out, and them shoulder pads and them spikes sticking up, and you would hear that boom, 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 boom. I was a little 12-year-old boy, and I was like, man, I could run through a brick wall right now. All because the power of that sound that was being released out of them. There's a sound that the enemy has released on this generation that is bringing out negative vibes and negative emotion. And God didn't leave the church here to put up with it. God left the church here to create a sound of praise that drowns out the sound of the enemy, that quits calling young girls bad names. Come on, somebody, and tells them that they are sons and daughters of God. There's sounds, there's media, there's music, there's money, all these things messing with the images of the people. Jesus came to show us what that image really should mean. Jesus, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. How many of you think of Jesus as nice, as your best friend, but you're kind of scared of God? Carlene used to have trouble praying because she's like, I just like talking to Jesus because I'm afraid of God. This is when we were young, immature believers. Because the image of Jesus is whosoever will. But the image of God is, I will throw you into the lake of fire. But Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen my Father. For I am the Father, we are one. Jesus said, I've come to re-image my Father to you. Because you are seeing him wrong. I've come to re-image what you should be doing. You shouldn't be living in fear and in denial. I have come to show you that I will give you power and authority. And in my name, you will speak with new tongues. In my name, you'll cast out devils. In my name, if you drink any deadly thing, it will not harm you. Does anybody believe there's power in the image of Christ? Satan hated Jesus more than anything he had ever seen because the image was perfectly represented to humanity. You couldn't say God's evil because there was Jesus doing good. You couldn't say God don't care because there was Jesus caring for people nobody else cared about. You couldn't say God is distant because there was Jesus right among the lepers and the broken. So what did Jesus do? What did the enemy do? The enemy lied on him, smeared the image of him, made people believe he was a deceiver, made people change their mind about him the same way people change their mind about you. And the next thing you know, they crucified the only perfect man to ever live. And they put him in a tomb. And these people were so bent on making sure the only image you thought of when you thought of Jesus was failure that the Bible said, one translation, they put a seal around the tomb, John. I can't imagine what kind of material and what kind of mortar they used back then. But they sealed it because they said, if we don't seal the tomb, his disciples are liable to come and snatch his body in the night, and then his image will give them hope again. So not only did they seal it to keep him down, they had guards watching over him to make sure he stayed down. Can I tell you the tragedy with life is there's been too many people in the church that once you got knocked down, they tried to seal your fate and say, that's all you're ever going to be, Sean. That's all you're ever going to be, Bubba. That's all you're ever going to be, Kathy. And it's a tragedy when we want people's image to be of their worst moment. They wanted it that when you thought of Jesus, you thought of that dead, lifeless body, that pierced side, the nail scars in his hands and feet. That when you thought of Jesus, you thought of failure. That when you thought of Jesus, you thought of liar and you thought of deceiver. But can I tell you that God's opinion is always greater than the opinion of man? And on the third day, though they had done sealed the deal, God said, I don't care what they said about your son. I'm rolling the stone away and I'm going to bring you out. I got a word for somebody. God don't care what they said about you. He's going to roll the stone away and bring you out. Yes, he is. Now, that image, if he hadn't got up, that image would have meant failure. But because he got up, that image means victory. Because if he got up, I can get up too. If he kept going, I can keep going too. Oh, God. Well, I look way over yonder. What do you think I see? I see a band of angels that coming after me because they know. I better stop. That song means something to me. Because he defeated death, hell, and the grave. And that is the ultimate image of victory. So now the enemy says, oh, Lord, that image still gives people hope. So what can I do? I got to change the meaning of the image to this generation. And have you ever noticed Hollywood movies, they only have two kinds of churches. They got the John Boy Walton church, you know, the Tweedledum church where the pastor don't know nothing and he kind of just fumbles around, and you got about 5 or 10 people in his church and they all just feel sorry for each other and nothing's really happening, but it's sweet, you know, sweet little church. That's one image. But then anytime in Hollywood, if you notice, if a church is doing good, the pastor knows how to manage the money and the people are coming, the pastor's always a crook. So Hollywood gives you two versions to pick of church. Either the little bumbling idiot church or the crooks that won't take your money church. I'm here to tell you that ain't neither one of the church. The devil ain't going to define this church. That in 1 Kings chapter 3, I want you to see this, and I'll tell you the whole story. But this came from a conversation I had with my mother the other day. In 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 16, I want y'all to see this right here. Then came there two, everybody say two. Two women that were harlots unto the king. And they stood before him. And the one woman said, oh, my Lord, I and this woman dwell in one house. And I was delivered of a child and her with her in the house. And it came to pass the third day after that I was delivered that this woman was delivered also. And we were together. There was no stranger with us in the house save only us two in the house. Next verse. And she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me while thine handmaid slept and laid it in her bosom and laid it, her dead child in my bosom. Okay, now for the sake of time, I won't read no more, but let me break that down for you. Solomon was a new king. God said, Solomon, ask me for anything you want. You know, he didn't ask for a Cadillac. He didn't ask for a Rolls Royce. He didn't ask for fame. Solomon was getting ready to be the leader of the nation of Israel. And he knew if he was going to lead God's people, there was one thing he couldn't lead without. He got in the presence of God and he said, God, I ask for you to give me wisdom. The book of James tells us to ask, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God who giveth unto all men liberally. And he gets in the presence of God and said, God, I need some wisdom. And God said, because you have asked for wisdom, not only will I grant you wisdom, but I will grant you everything that comes with it. Now comes the trial of wisdom because he's a new king. And you got two women. This is worse than any courtroom scenario you can think of. And you got both of them making claim to the same baby. And what it was, two harlots, two women lived in the same house. They both had children at the same time. And at night, one of them had slept on hers the wrong way. And the other one, you know, her baby was fine. Something happened. Nobody knows what happened to the baby. The baby died. So when the baby died, she switched babies in the night and took the living baby. The mama woke up the next morning. And she saw her baby, it was dead and it was lifeless. And she looked across the room and she could tell that the other woman had stole her baby and replaced her baby with a dead baby. That's what religion always tries to do, is steal the life out of you and replace it with dead, cold religion. And so now they come in the presence of the king, and they said, what shall we do, O king? Because they didn't have DNA testing back then. They didn't have all this high-tech stuff that we have today to determine it. And so this king had to have a wisdom that came from another world. So the king looked at the two women. He pondered the situation. And the king said, since I can neither decide whether this child be yours or yours, I say split it down the middle and you both take a part. And he looked for the reaction of the women. And the one woman that was like, yeah. The other woman said, no. Before you kill that baby, let her have it. Just don't kill the baby. That told the king all that he needed to know. Let me tell you who the real church is. Not the one that gets mad and tries to destroy everything because they didn't get it their way, but the one that said, God, even if it ain't my way, let your purpose live. Let thy will be done. Let thy kingdom the earth as it is in heaven. And he said, thou art the mother. Would the real church please stand up? We are the mother church. We are the church that is called to protect and preserve. Everybody standing. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. Lift your hands to the King of Kings. I felt something. Whoop. Pete, I love you, man. I felt something shift right there. Because there have been times in my life that I didn't know what to do, but I prayed for wisdom, and he gave it to me. Some of you, even as I was preaching it, I felt that just pull on me right there. I'm not going to call you up, because the Bible didn't say you had to come up in an altar call for wisdom. The Bible said, if any man lack wisdom, if any woman lack wisdom, let them ask. For every situation you don't feel like you have the wisdom for, I just want you to lift up your hands to God right now and ask him. And if you ask in your heart, believing, God will give you wisdom concerning that relationship, wisdom concerning that situation, wisdom concerning that lie that the enemy's tried to spread to you, wisdom concerning that thing you are battling. God, I thank you for wisdom for your people. I thank you for wisdom upon them right now that is greater than the situations and the problems that they are facing. Wisdom is coming your way right now. Now everybody begin to worship, because I want you to know something. I'm going to ask you to do this. Second Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. I'm pretty sure this is the one I'm looking for. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. I ain't got my glasses on tonight. And I know I'm asking for a lot, but I want everybody to see this. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. When we allow the Lord to take the veil off our face, the things they've said about us, the things we've said about ourselves, the mistakes we made, when we just take all that junk off and we begin to look at God for who we are, God says that's the image you'll be changed into. If you see a grouchy God, you're going to be a grouchy little Christian. If you see a defeated God, you're going to be a defeated believer. But if you see the God of this book, if you see the God of this city, you're going to be a person full of hope, a person full of light. And when they look at you, they're going to see the image of him. And they're going to say, I want to serve a God that is like that. For we are the image carriers of the glory of a mighty God. I want you to lift those hands and worship him as they sing. Let God just love on you tonight. Let him just love on you.
Hey, I'm Pastor Barry Absher. I want to thank you guys for liking and subscribing to our channel. All the feedback that we've received, it's been such a blessing. If you've not subscribed to our channel, I wanted to take this time to personally ask you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're really excited about what God is doing here at City on a Hill. And we're also excited about what God is doing in your life and in our lives together. Let's be part of the internet family. Let's link up. Let's join. Continue to watch our videos. Like, subscribe. Let's get on the train together and see what happens. God bless you so much. Bye-bye.